of North Queensland and Cairns. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Mr. Robbie Katter.
Thanks for that. Welcome, and you probably might have didn't observe that I was also interested in the Swedish backpackers.
Salutation to the sun.
We've acknowledged the guests. I didn't see Councillor Mayor John Morton here, but just wanted to say, you know, that shows you what this means to some people around the place. That'll be about a 15-hour drive, I'd say 14-hour drive from Richmond here to get here. But and I know, John's called for this before and been very vocal on the subject. But there's a lot of people out west, believe very strongly in this cause, and I just make an acknowledgement of that. And I'm trying to gear my speech not to be so much about the rural issues, despite sort of being from there and representing that area. I've been in politics, it's coming on 7 years, I've been involved in the state scene, and we had five rural seats going down to four, because our towns are getting smaller, because I'd argue with the policy direction and the decisions that are not made and the attention we don't get from government have ensured that we diminish in those rural areas, and the size of the parliament's increased, as Bill said earlier, from only 9 to 93, so we've diluted for more our influence in parliament. And I'd already argue that the influence is poor, and I can assure you that the conversations now from the major parties are how do you take back government by, you got to win back Brisbane, and that one of those conversations was with the one of the party operatives down there, and that was in the context of the tree clearing debate, because they said, well, you know, we know we can improve from this position on this, and it makes it hard for the other side to catch up, because they've got to win Brisbane seats. Now, they know language, and there is some goodwill down there in Parliament, but my 7 years, and Shane has been there 14 years, I think, would attest to the fact that the main language they speak is seats and winning re-election, and that's done by winning Brisbane. I think last time I counted, it's about 56 seats just in the Brisbane area, and that's without acknowledging the cluster of ones that sit around it that share similar values. So the policy alienation is growing. That's that indifference from a government 2,000 kilometres away. It's like, you know, some people say they must hate us. Well, they don't hate us, they're just indifferent. And there's cultural divide, just keeps moving. And it's hard for me to be on the ground and try and, you know, get around my electorate and talk with them in Brisbane. But the reverse is becoming so much harder. They're trying to connect with people out here, and I think there's a growing reluctance from politicians to mix with people on the ground. And you try and put that against these areas for 2,000 kilometres away from Brisbane, and tell me how you think that's going to work out for you. What are some of the outcomes of what we experienced? I just want to give you a quick sort of cross-section of things that we've seen. One interesting one was the Year 7 transition, which was, when the state was broke and couldn't afford anything, they introduced $900 million program to cut and paste Year 7, same curriculum, but let's put it on a high school campus, which cost us $900 million to do that. And I at the time said the education minister, well, hang on, there's a lot of schools in my electorate don't have a high school. So parents are going to spend an extra 30 or 40 grand to keep their kids in education. And then can't you just leave the teachers, leave Year 7 in the remainder as it is? And I spoke to the education department people, and they said, yeah, you can do it. But again, indifference just said, oh, we, you know, didn't really think of that. And they didn't change it. Like, they wouldn't accommodate just a simple thing that caused so much heartache in towns. And again, came with the national curriculum in School of the Air for kids, where they rolled it out. And in the words of the School of the Air teacher out there, he said, it's been nothing short of catastrophic. And I've been in this 21 years, I think, said the game just and said. They just rolled it out. The parents parents had tears in their eyes. They couldn't download data because they hadn't set it up properly for these kids, and that was another mess. The tree clearing laws, we could talk about them ad nauseum, but that you clearly had people down there that just didn't know what they were talking about, and I was trying to be fair to them in the debate to say, look, I know your intentions are good, but you just don't understand how ridiculous these arguments were, and were completely contradicting what the these natural resource management groups were telling them from up here about like best practice for the graziers, and then they'd say the opposite, they were voting the opposite down there. And I won't go into too much detail on that, but the crocodiles and the flying foxes were just ridiculous outcomes for us when we're trying to manage things in a common sense way. And it's just that cultural divide that it doesn't enable them to have a clear picture of how these things should be managed. And I just, just the cross-section again of outcomes, health's always the one to concentrate on, but you're 47% more likely to suffer an avoidable death in rural centres than in major urban centres due to lack of access to health professionals. If you're living outside major cities, you're 3 times more likely to die because of a transport accident than those living in major cities, attributable in part to longer waiting times for emergency services. The incidence of hospitalisation is 17% higher in remote and very remote areas than major cities. And I can just keep going with the health statistics, the education statistics, unemployment. I think last check was youth unemployment 67% in my region. The outcomes at the moment are terrible. And then on the flip side, say in Mount Isa, I often like when they say, well, it just doesn't stack up, or they want to talk about numbers, and I said, it's interesting you want to talk about numbers, because the Northwest, the average GDP per person is 186,000, and in the Southeast it's 63,000 per person. The more I've scratched the surface on this, and the more information I've been providing, and I'm trying to be objective here, it is just so overwhelming and comprehensive, the arguments that are in our favour. And I do like getting away from the argument. I hear a lot, we're not getting our fair share, and I that's true. I totally agree. But I think the argument, and which is what I've been asked to focus on today, is not so much on just not getting our fair share. It's we want to provide the right for prosperity for our people up here, and we've been denied that right through poor management, inefficient management of our resources and our policy management. It's done inefficiently from a government 2,000 kilometres away. So it's not we're not getting enough money off you. It's we can do things so much better for you if you let us manage ourselves. It's that local autonomy and we can provide so much better to the national GDP and the Queensland State Parliament, State Government's budget. We can provide so much better input to that if you let us make some decisions up here. And you'd say, well, what are some of the barriers there? Where's evidence of that cultural divide when you consider that? And it was on a radio interview with someone in Melbourne, and one of the radio journalists in Melbourne said, well, but isn't the big risk here, like, if you're left to yourselves up there, wouldn't that really compromise like Indigenous issues and environmental issues? And I was gobsmacked. Said, well, that's really the problem, isn't it? Like, I would have said that you would get a lot better outcomes for Indigenous people and environment, because we live up there and live amongst these problems and know it. And you're saying that we would manage it less. Well, that's the real problem, isn't it? Like, you want this paternalistic attitude where you're a lot smarter than us and we're not mature enough to make these decisions for ourselves. There is the real evidence of that mindset that is working against us here. And it's why every time, you'll hear a counter-argument on the radio with the existing, governments of the day saying, they'll try and pad this down and say, it's ridiculous, and, you just can't afford it. And they always throw away little arguments, but no one will engage us properly in these debates, because, like I said, the more you scratch the surface here, the more it works in our favour. So I want to talk, just give some examples to people of how you can improve. And I'm sure, given that most of you are here, you've probably got your own ideas of how we can do things better. But in terms of resources, John Warden here from Richmond Shire on the Flinders River. You've got the Mitchell River here, which I understand is one of the biggest rivers in Australia in terms of water volume. And everyone else in Australia was allowed to develop and harvest water from the river in all sorts of ways, but it got up to here, and now there's all these impositions because everyone wants to feel warm and cuddly about the environment or looking after things, so it's easier for them to put that in position to stifle us. So, you know, again, if you're talking about the Mitchell River or the Flinders River, we politely watch millions of megalitres of water go down the river every year, and if we were down south in the Murray-Darling, where there's a lot of greenies looking at how much they can take 30% of the water, we're probably taking under 1% of water at the moment out of the Flinders. And there's infinitely less coming out of the Mitchell and others, but if you were allowed to even harvest that water, say to people, take as much as you want, because you're not taking much of the money, you're only taking them 1%. Take as much as you want, go and build some, you know, tighten up the grazing industry and put some irrigation down so that you can get through the protein drought and you can run, you know, 4,000 head of cattle instead of 2,000 head of cattle like you are now. That would do amazing things for our GDP. It would be amazing things for our town. You know, in my area, Richmond and Dew Creek, Hillenden doesn't have to go asking for roads money or more, you know, hospital schools money, because they start to become self-sufficient. We're generating jobs and income, and we'd be less burden on the government, but we're not allowed to take water out of the river because people down south want to impose their value set on us, wouldn't know the first thing about it. And you know, I've had a string of very frustrating conversations both sides where, you know, you're trying to get through them that, you know, your problem is not pricing the water or, you know, the rules set around. Your problem is trying to get one person to take some of that water out. But they don't understand that. They're just all carried away. You know, they think it's completely different settings for them. So they don't understand the issues. And but just on water harvesting alone, up here, the North Johnson transfer, the things you could do if we just had a little bit of autonomy that would more efficiently manage our resources is incredible. I always liken it to I think the best analogy to use is the North Queensland Cowboys, because they didn't have the resources. You know, they'll say now, well, you don't have the resources, you couldn't afford it, which is, I think you'll see is easily disproved. But no, the North Queensland Cowboys didn't have the resources. They didn't have enough money to even make their salary cap in the day. I didn't think they'd ever go that well. You know, I love them, but I didn't think they were ever gonna go that well. We'd never build up and don't have the player base, don't have the money, don't have the businesses to support them. Well, how wrong we were. And how good is the game of rugby league, national rugby league now, from having the Cowboys there, because they grew players, the businesses got behind them, it grew economy for Townsville, and now we've got, and it's strengthened the state of origin side, it's a timely thing to bring up, but the, and in the same way we can do that with our economy. We can grow ourselves, we're mature enough. And like, you know, the ABC Journal said in Melbourne, we're mature enough to better manage environment issues, Indigenous issues, these economic development, and we can make these settings more appropriate to the environment that we live in. They mentioned the more politicians argument. I'll raise it, but I don't even think it's worth, for the benefits that we can deliver to the country and to our state, you really should say the country, I guess. It far outweighs any, that's a petty argument in terms of what we can achieve, what we can deliver if we run ourselves. And I think it was Bill saying before, you know, this is, I feel the most frustrating thing that comes up with this topic. Journalists sort of think, oh, it's just a stunt, but mums and dads say, the amount of conversation I've had too is, yeah, mate, you know, good idea, it's never going to happen. That's the height of ignorance to me. And, you know, good thinking people have thought about this and realised that it's a good, and not people from North Queensland, there's people from other areas around, there's academics from around the country who are saying this is the height of ignorance and naivety. They think the next 1,000 years, these lines that were drawn on a map 150 years ago have to be there in perpetuity. Those lines just stay there forever. But at some stage, you would have to say, is there a cultural divide? Are we managing these resources and these people as best we can as the landscape changes? That's the question we need to ask ourselves, and that's what mum and dads need to ask themselves at home. Have the conversation and have a, you know, mature discussion about it. And when those mums and dads start talking to their mates, and saying, look, it's a good idea. There's no reason we shouldn't be doing this. That's when the politicians start getting scared, because they can't bluff you anymore into saying, oh, it'll never happen, and, and dampening it down. That's when we start connecting in politics. And you watch how fast the winds change once the politicians get a whiff, especially up here, that they, you know, their job's on the line if they don't start supporting this cause. So it really does start at home with having those discussions with your friends and engaging them. Don't let them get away with saying, making those ignorant sort of statements like, oh, it'll never happen. Well, it'll never happen as long as people keep saying that. That's an absolute certain, and very frustrating. I just wanted to share you with you one more story that Shane will attest to. When we had the motion, I think Shane put it up in that last parliament for a separate state, and Nick wasn't there at the time, but we had a debate on the separate state, and it was pretty pathetic, the arguments that came up against it. The government say, well, you can't afford it, to which you'd say, well, that's good. I mean, then we'll be less of a burden on you. Wouldn't that be an incentive to at least have a study, which we call for, a $250,000 study, to say, well, let's even just scratch the surface on this and say if it is so silly or if we can afford it. But, though, I mean, that's as much an argument against itself. But they tried to debate, and it was a pretty, you know, poor debate. I thought we did a reasonable job, Shane. But probably about two or three MPs, I won't name them, but two were Brisbane, said, it's not a bad idea, Rob, after they just voted against it. And they said, but, you know, we should be looking at the NT border. We should be taking probably the low one down to Clarence. You know, so there's thinking people here that realise how stupid it is to keep doing the same thing for 150 years and then for the next 1,000 years. There's people know you need to challenge what we're doing and where we are, but politically it's not convenient for them. So everyone here has to make it politically very inconvenient. And, like I pointed out at the start, that we don't have the seats, but you do have MPs in your own electorate that are saying right now, oh, it'll never happen and we get our fair share. Well, it's your job to put pressure on them, because there, I can tell you there's people down that path that know it's a good idea, and as soon as the politics works in our favour, and Peter can go into the mechanics of how it can happen, things can happen very fast. So the first step and the main message I want to get across to you tonight is we can deliver a hell of a lot to Australia. This is not about being a burden. This is about us delivering prosperity for us again, and then stop from going backwards, stop us losing seats in the parliament. But it starts with people believing that it can happen at this level. Sounds cliche, but I honestly believe that's a very primary goal we need to achieve from here. And you know, I imagine most of you are believers here today, but we need to spread that message. And until there's pressure on your MPs, particularly in these northern areas, it's not going to go far. So thanks very much for having me.